It's 1978. You've seen Star Wars a billion times, until they stopped playing it in theaters. Blizzards are killing people dead if they go outside for too long. And serial killers from coast to coast are getting the ones that the snow doesn't. What is a person to do for entertainment in a world and a time like this? Well, they turn on their radio and dial over to FM, where all the latest, greatest tunes are playing. In sunny LA, that's Los Angeles, director and DJ Jeff Dugan has assembled a ragtag group of radio voices, talents, tears, and tracks together under one rock and roll station with more sides than a dodecahedron. The name of the station is Q Sky. Q Sky gets you so high you'll never come down to Earth. Unfortunately, the success of the radio station attracts the attention of the military, who want to pay Q Sky to use their airtime so that they can play fake songs that are really military ads instead of the hits. The radio station owners think it's a great idea. Director Dugan, detecting dastardly disco downwind, disagrees. So the radio station fires him. Sensing a heavy harsh to their mellow vibes, Dugan's fellows of the Q Skies crowd lock the doors and go on strike, demanding that their bosses stop being squares and let the music and the good times roll. Will they succeed? 1978's FM, it's basically an album that has a movie based around it. From its very first moment until its last, nearly every scene in this film has a classic rock song playing in the background. So, to someone like me who likes classic rock, or as it was called back then in the 70s, rock, I guess, FM is a fun time. A movie that most definitely is improved with a little bit of alcohol and probably other things you can consume if you want to maintain a government job. All the music in the film is appropriate, it's iconic to the time, and it flows, and it makes FM a really cool movie. It's cool. It knew it was cool back then. It might have been seen as kind of cheesy at the time, but it works now, in my opinion, looking back. And that may be nostalgia, but I think it's a fun time. And boy, does that music ever flow. The film includes Eagles, Steve Miller, Steely Dan, Joe Walsh, Foreigner, who I'm not so big on, a little too commercial for me, Doobie Brothers, Queen. The list goes on, with most tracks being great. It's not a surprise that the soundtrack for this movie, FM, basically a one-stop record for a bevy of hits that you really couldn't get all in one place back then, was incredibly popular and sold at least a million records. Speaking of albums, FM, not just because it has a bunch of music playing, is like an album. And when I say it's like an album, I mean that, like any album, you're gonna like some parts of this movie more than others, like you would like some songs on an album more than others. This is especially true of the humor in FM, which is dopey, and it's not the greatest ever, it's the weakest part of the movie. You're gonna see classics like drug humor.
Tammy, let's go. Tammy, you've had enough Coke.
Funny. Coke reference. Classic casual racism hung on the wall in the workplace. Whoopee. Police sure are stupid humor. I mean, hey, I don't like pigs, but this is like, wow, that's a lame joke. There's no real intelligence there. All in all, the laughs are a mixed bag. As chaotic as the decor and macrame monstrosities hanging on the walls of the Q Sky radio station. That's what that stuff is, by the way. If you're old enough, you may have parents that had that kind of stuff hanging around. My parents had a macrame frog, and I was like, what is that? It's so weird. It's like macrame, and then it's got two ceramic frog eyes. It's bizarre. FM is notably impressive given that 1978 was probably the last year you could actually make a movie like this. That was the year that the legal copyright revisions officially took effect in the US. This was the first time that copyright was recognized, codified, and enforced, especially for music. Many films were made using lots of popular music. It was just a cool thing to do, no big deal. Yet after copyright's enforcement in 1978, well now, now you had to pay specific people specific large amounts of money to use those songs in your movie. That's why I think 1978 was the last time a movie like FM could really occur. A dopey comedy getting such a soundtrack. A soundtrack that's nearly 2 hours of top tracks from the biggest artists of all time. And it's not like they're using a bunch of B-sides or anything with this. No. Most of the music in this is like top 10 artists and their top 10 hits type music. It's all stuff you're going to recognize. And while Steely Dan's FM was crafted for the movie itself, a lot of the music in the movie, in fact, most of it, is just used to fill in the background of scenes. I would kill to have been in the room when they were discussing FM soundtrack, because this is how it would go. Oh, hey, dude, we got a Fly Like an Eagle, you know, Steve Miller's song, you know, number two U.S. Billboard Hot 100 from 1976, 1977. You know, that song, you might have heard it. Oh, cool, are we using that as, like, the theme of the movie? That's going to be, like, the biggest song, right? No, it's going to be we're going to use it when they're sitting down and talking, that scene. Would have been effing hilarious to listen to that. I can't imagine the decision process behind it, but they had enough music that they could use Fly Like an Eagle for a talking scene. You can't even hear the song. People are talking over it. It seems impossible and remarkable looking back on it today, but here is this film sneaking in at the back door of the 70s, arriving in style right as that copyright conundrum hit America. That same copyright, by the way, which will make this video unprofitable to me forever, because I'm going to use music in it. Oh well. Wow. So, enjoy this film as a rare find. My opinion as a movie critic, this is a very rare type of movie. It's a representation of something that can no longer be due to our constant push for progress and the complications that follow that push for progress. FM is a glimpse into a simpler time. It's a nostalgic movie, even though I wasn't aware of that time. I wasn't alive during that time to be aware of it. But it's kind of like that magical place where concerts were simply people listening to music. Nobody was filming it with an iPhone or whatever. Record stores were filled with people, and they existed. They are coming back now, but for the past 20 years, they did not exist. Not largely, but they're coming back. FM is pretty close to my fantasy mental image of the world that my parents met in. It was America during the 1970s. This was the music that was playing. It was a world of post-Vietnam exuberance. People just wanted to kind of set aside the save the world mentality from the hippies, and they said, let's focus on saving the whales and just have a lot of fun and listen to music that only exists to accompany snorting drugs. So the music in FM, that world that the music communicates, still comes through today. Classic rock radio stations still play these songs, and they've been playing them every single day since the 1970s. So people are aware of this music, but it's gonna seem like dinosaur stuff to some of the people watching this review. It's a movie filled with what people call dad rock. That's a new term I heard. They said it's dad rock, as in, like, my dad listens to that. Well, I have a story about that. To me, the music in FM classic rock, that's mom music, because that's what my mom would play in the car when she was driving. That's where I learned about all this music, and it built a lot of the basis for my interest in music, because she was always playing that. When we would go on car trips or road trips, that's the kind of music, classic rock, I associate that with car trips and road trips. That's America to me. So earlier this year, I sat in a hospital room with my mother. She had suffered brain damage from cancer treatment complications, which I mentioned on my channel and other places. Still going through it, still treating her, still trying to help her out. At that time, she was really poorly off. She was blind. She couldn't talk intelligibly. She could mumble. You wouldn't understand what she was saying. She would fall asleep at any moment, and then she would just kind of wake and stare at the ceiling. You didn't know, you know, what was going on. We didn't know if she was going to survive. She was kind of stable. She had gotten out of the ICU, but now she's just sitting in a hospital bed, just kind of hanging out. So I sat with her. I would say words to her, but I wasn't sure if she could understand or really even hear me. I was unable to speak with her, but I was able to communicate with her. And you may be thinking, like, you just said you couldn't talk to her or understand her. So I put my phone down on the table next to her bed, and I played Steely Dan's Kid Charlemagne. And I sat back and I just looked at her, and we just listened to music. This was a song that she had introduced to me on one of the last car trips I took with my mom. She played that song and exposed me to it, and I liked it. So I thought, you know, let's play it. So we just sat there and we listened to music. And I looked down on the bed while the music was playing, and her fingers are tapping on the bed along to the beat. Mom's still there. She's still here. I give FM 4DD Dolores Deluxes out of 5. Yeah, the 1970s were pretty crazy. I mean, Bundy, Gacy, and Jim Jones all existed simultaneously in 1978. But at least she could listen to decent music, static-free, on FM.
All of these things are designed to frighten a monkey.